If we go back to the starting point of the European Union in the 1950s, it was about the idea that through economic integration, we can achieve peace.
But they take on migrants because it's cheaper than investing in new machinery. And that is a mistake, if you like, that capitalism makes.
The ultra-right see the foreign worker as somebody who's undermining their basic standards.
This was the point in time, wasn't it, where we started to see the start of the assimilation of right-wing ideas into the mainstream.
The end days of communism had brought uncertainty and opportunity to Europe. Still coming to terms with the war in Yugoslavia that had left more than 2 million refugees in its wake, Western Europe pressed ahead with its most ambitious plan for greater integration. It would be signed into effect in 1992 in the Dutch city of Maastricht.
The Maastricht Treaty was about the single currency, but Maastricht overall was plainly leading towards the creation of a political entity in Europe, a European state, a European government.
There are over a dozen EU institutions, bureaucratic institutions, that most people, I mean, your average voter, didn't even know were being erected. They didn't know that when they voted to ratify the Maastricht Treaty, that you would have the emergence of this state-like bureaucracy in Brussels.
As well as paving the way for a common currency, the euro, the Maastricht Treaty made the 12 member states beholden to shared economic, social, and security policies. The political and economic strings of Europe were being pulled from the EU headquarters in Brussels. The gap between governance and the governed was getting ever greater.
Suddenly you have all of these rules you have to follow, standards you have to meet, when maybe your family has been farming for centuries and has never changed anything. And now some bureaucrat in Brussels is telling you that your farming practices are wrong and you have to invest into upgrading, and that costs a lot of money. Many of the processes of EU economic and political integration were happening sort of, now I wouldn't say they were hidden, but they were unseen by your average European.
When borders started to disappear, they felt that they lost identity. And so it led to a debate about identity and how much are we still Dutch or German or Danish, and how much are we European, and how much do we want to be European?
By 1999, as the European common currency, the euro, was finally launched, that debate was picked up by a spate of newly established or newly invigorated populist nationalist parties. The True Finns in Finland, the Sweden Democrats and the Danish People's Party were all to some degree vehicles for anti-EU sentiments. France's Front National refocused its own nationalist manifesto against the supranational union, while in Britain, the UK Independence Party would begin to campaign to get Britain out of Europe. In Austria, Jörg Haider, a man with known fascist sympathies, led the far-right, anti-immigration, Austrian Freedom Party to second place in the 1999 parliamentary elections, earning it a voice in the coalition government and a rebuke from the European Union.
The EU imposes diplomatic sanctions on Austria and says, I'm afraid until you can prove this party endorses the values of Europe, rights for minorities and equality for all, you know, we will not be removing those sanctions.
Jörg Haider's reign at the head of the Austrian Freedom Party would end within months of entering the coalition government. But at the dawn of a new millennium, Austria had shown that after half a century of being held in check, nationalism was rising through Europe and taking a new form.
Across Western Europe, you start to see new form of racism in the form of Islamophobia. And that happens in different European countries in different ways.
What they are concerned about our socio-cultural issues, about identity, about Islam, about people changing their country, taking away their sovereignty. Those are issues that you can discuss when your basic issues are being dealt with. So when your country is secure and when you are affluent, you can be busy with radical right issues like national identity. And so that is one of the explanations why it would happen in countries like Denmark and Austria, the Netherlands later.
The Netherlands would see the far-right, anti-immigration, anti-Muslim, Pim Fortuyn List party finish second with 17% of the vote in its 2002 general election. In the same year, France would also go to the polls, and a familiar voice would make a historic breakthrough.
En attendant, n'ayez pas peur de rêver. Vous, les petits, les sans-grades, les exclus, les ouvrières et les ouvriers de toutes ces industries ruinées par l'euro-mondialisme de Maastricht, j'appelle les Françaises et les Français à se rallier à cette chance historique de redressement national.
By the time we get into the early 2000s, Jean-Marie Le Pen has reached such a point that he is able to reach the second round of the presidential election against a long-standing member of the French establishment, Jacques Chirac.
In the 2002 French presidential elections, Jean-Marie Le Pen had beaten the sitting socialist prime minister, Lionel Jospin, to win a place in a two-way runoff with the incumbent president, Jacques Chirac.
After that, millions of French went out in the streets and decided to protest against Jean-Marie Le Pen, against his victory, even his participation in this election. And after that, people voted for Jacques Chirac, even if they were not rightist voters. And he was elected with 82% of voices. So, but it was not the end of the story. It was just one step in something worse.
Tous les moyens ont été lancés pour éviter justement que ce premier tour ne se traduise par une victoire de nationaliste, disons. Une mobilisation générale de l'établissement contre la candidature de Jean-Marie Le Pen. Et Jacques Chirac a obtenu plus de 80% des voix et n'en a rien fait. Parce que c'était artificiel.
There were many people who didn't accept the situation of immigrants in France. The problem of security became a very important issue for French people. And once again, it was the trial of immigrants. And Jean-Marie Le Pen was the symbol of the existential crisis of the French society.
Jean-Marie Le Pen had symbolized France's existential crisis and posed as an existential threat to a European Union that in 2004 embarked on its most ambitious enlargement. It now included 10 new countries, 8 from Central and Eastern Europe. With more people moving from poorer European nations to richer ones in search of work, immigration was, once again, under the spotlight.
The major issue was the free movement of labor and the influx of cheap labor from mostly Poland and Hungary, which upset a lot of people.
The demand then continuously through that period is tougher immigration controls, particularly the idea that government is too cosmopolitan, that the leaders do not really share the kind of native instincts of the ordinary people.
One fringe party in Britain put itself forward to stand up for the instincts of the ordinary native people of the UK.
The UK Independence Party, or UKIP, which essentially was a Eurosceptic party that had been struggling in the wilderness since the 1990s, but now realises that actually, with concerns over immigration and concerns over the EU, it could do much better. And UKIP comes into British politics and quickly turns itself into a very serious political force that becomes the third most popular party in the country.
In 2006, UKIP elected a new leader, Nigel Farage, a man whose accession, according to the party's founder, brought with it elements of far-right support.
When he took over the leadership, he had ex-National Front candidates fighting for UKIP. There's always been ex-BNP National Front people involved in UKIP. There's all sorts of ex-criminal types been allowed to be candidates by Farage.
Nigel Farage's UK Independence Party tried to present a veneer of respectability as it and the far-right movement it claimed to be removed from made inroads into Europe's political mainstream. In 2008, the financial meltdown, which had begun with a credit crisis in the US, would be a catalyst for political and social unrest across Europe and give the far-right a chance to rush in where the mainstream feared to tread.
It was a dramatic period as banks had overstretched their capacity to lend.
And we saw countries like Greece taking on mass debt, going into default. We saw countries like Spain and Italy doing the same thing, Portugal as well. We started to see not a Europe united, but a Europe divided.
In Greece, the simmering financial crisis boiled over into street violence. The Greek Prime Minister, George Papandreou, committed to a 110 billion euro bailout by the Troika of the European Commission, the European Central Bank, and the International Monetary Fund. In return, Greece would be required to make drastic cuts to its public spending, reduce its budget deficit, and liberalize its markets. The Greeks would pay for the money they received and the folly of a hasty integration.
The recourse to austerity was, of course, rooted in economic orthodoxy, but was not calculated to meet the demands of those who were the losers in that project.
I had to take these very difficult measures. I knew that many of these were unjust, but otherwise our country would have fallen off the brink. We would have gone bankrupt.
Greece was being forced to swallow this very painful pill of austerity to save the EU. And what we really saw is growing resentment, both on the side of the rich countries like Germany and France, and also on the side of the countries that needed support, the poorer European countries like Greece, Spain, Portugal, and Italy.
This idea that we in the north now had to pay for them in the south, right, hit home hard. It was also the first time that we saw the so-called dark side of the euro, that our currency was now linked to the behavior of others, including people in the south, about which we already had a lot of prejudices.
The financial crisis really an enormously significant moment for the European Union, because its true colours were revealed, that in the end it decided to back the system and the banks above the interests of the people. That's right, isn't it? I imagine you must agree with that in Greece.
Yes, it's somewhat more complex, but yes, it was obviously bailing out the banks. We had made finance a god. The financial system was a god, and they were putting too much in the basket of financing and banking and so on. That they will solve the problems of unemployment or growth and so on, which is not come to fruition, and particularly in Europe. But this problem then became, rather than a Eurozone common effort, it became sort of every nation has to deal with it, and then to burden on the citizens and the taxpayers.
I would have assumed that for people who are sceptical of the European Union, or parts of it at least, it was a gift. The collapse of the banks has over time been jumped on by these parties.
Two things here. Don't bracket me as a Eurosceptic. I'm a moderate integrationist.
Okay.
Secondly,
but you accept the point.
The crisis took time to work through. It was not an immediate crisis. I mean, the finance world, of course, understood that if they don't bail out the banks, then who knows what would happen, Armageddon. We avoided that. So that was positive. But then whose money was used for this? Well, either it was funny money, non-existent money, or taxpayers' money.
Yeah, the point I'm trying to get at is that through the decisions that they took, that the people in Brussels ended up laying the ground for the populist right, didn't they?
I think Brussels obviously has to bear some share of the blame, but Brussels as Council of Ministers rather than the Commission. In other words, as Yorgos was saying, each and every member state had to take a decision of some kind, come together in Brussels and work out a solution. They're still working on it. They still haven't got a proper governance system for the euro.
I mean, during this period, from 2008 onwards, when it turned out, it became a sovereign debt crisis instead of a banking crisis, the media and a variety of politicians started to talk about lazy Greeks not paying tax, for one thing, and the hard-working North and the lazy South, because you're all having three-hour lunches. I have heard people myself say this in the Netherlands. It started to run an absolute wedge through the idea of European unity, all this, didn't it?
Well, I think...
And help the populist anti-European right at the same time.
I think one of the major reasons for the rise of this sort of anti-EU or populist or xenophobic rhetoric was the financial crisis and the narratives that came out of that. And the narratives were blame games. And blame games based on...
It's a diversion, wasn't it?
It was a diversion of the real issue. Because, as you said, we were these Zorba dancing, ouzo drinking, yeah, lazy Greeks, which of course may be an image that a tourist will get in an island of... But Greeks work hard. And the OECD facts say we are number one in hours of working hours in Europe. How can we be bedfellows if we think the Germans are too austere, they think that we're too lazy? Which has nothing to do with the fact that, in fact, the Eurozone structure needed changes. But if the Eurozone structure needed changes, then the responsibility was not on the Greeks.
And you're nodding.
It was on the whole of the European Union.
Well, I agree.
Or the whole of the Eurozone structure.
Yes, and now what the financial crisis has done, it has given these parties a very key pivot, because they were styling themselves then as anti-establishment, anti-immigrant parties. And at first, the establishment was the center, broadly defined. It was national politician. But now the establishment is the EU. And now the establishment is transatlanticism. And this has become the key driving force that the financial crisis unleashed for the far right. It gave them the ability to say, look, the EU has brought this upon us. In Greece, has brought us austerity. In Italy and Spain, massive unemployment. In Germany, we've had to pay our tax dollars, hard-earned money that we worked so hard for, into these lazy economies, right?
And also, where were the benefits? I want to ask you a question about Hungary, if I may, very quickly. The benefits of globalization to... I was in Miskolc the other month in northern Hungary. Terrible, dilapidated post-Soviet factories, Roma families knocking around, no work.
If you insist on visiting the Rust Belt, then that's what you will see.
Where's the benefit of globalization? And if you say to people there, well, look, you can have free movements, then it's rubbish.
I disagree with you. I mean, I think that there have been benefits, obviously, but what, certainly for Hungary, and not, I think, only for Hungary, is that whether the disbenefits really outweigh the benefits is hard to say. They're denied by the global elites who say, no, globalization is good for you. Well, there may be some losers. But if you are one of the losers, you know, then you say, well, wait a minute, who's talking about me?
They say this internationalist, technocratic governance which suppresses our freedom to express our own sovereignty is actually destructive. It's not bringing about prosperity, rather it's suppressing everything that is authentic, and it's suppressing our ways of life.
We really see the emergence of more and more and more of these political parties. And not just their emergence, but their ability to frame what's happening in Europe in a political agenda that benefits them.
In 2012, we had two elections that kind of created the frame. First, we had the elections in France, where Marine Le Pen did so well. And then we had the elections in Greece, where Golden Dawn did very well. They got 6%, which isn't really that remarkable in a European perspective, but it was a neo-Nazi party. And so those two together created this narrative of the far right wins during the crisis.
The 2012 elections in Greece saw Golden Dawn, a violent, openly fascist party, claim 18 seats in the Greek parliament. But it was a coalition government of traditional left and centre-right parties that held power in Athens. And despite widespread disdain for the EU's bailout plan, it soon set to work, implementing the imposed austerity. In France, Marine Le Pen, daughter of Jean-Marie, had taken over as leader of the Front National, shifting its emphasis to a centre ground that had already shifted to the right.
She wanted to convince more voters than the fans of her father. So she wanted to be attractive to, you know, Jews, Arabic people, the banlieue, women. She decided to be a normal politician.
The Front National would amplify its anti-EU credo under Marine Le Pen. And in a bid to exploit the perceived mood of the French people, she renounced her father's anti-Semitism and reclaimed the anti-Muslim rhetoric, now part of mainstream politics.
Je ne veux pas que mes filles soient cachées sous des burqas. Je ne veux pas qu'on m'impose de manger du halal. Je ne veux pas qu'on impose la charia à la place des lois de la République française.
The Muslim is the new symbol of the enemy. He's the new enemy, clearly. We say Muslim. We were citizens before that. But now everyone talked about Muslim people. They are not more French, they are not citizens anymore.
The twin-pronged attack on Muslims and the European Union gave Marine Le Pen 18% of the vote in the 2012 French presidential elections, proving that she was not only capable of emulating her father's achievements, but also had a chance of going beyond them. The political mood in France was volatile, but in 2015 it would be darkened by bloodshed on the streets of its capital city.
The nation remains stunned by these images.
Two black hooded gunmen making their escape in a hail of bullets.
A state of emergency in France after a night of gun and bomb attacks across Paris.
...2015 would begin and end with coordinated attacks in Paris that would make Europe's Muslim other, Europe's enemy, number one.
So every single party on the radical right uses this to show that Islam is the major threat, right? We cannot be safe without being fairly draconian, not just towards refugees and immigrants, but also towards Muslims in our own country.
That means that we have a crisis of citizenship, another one. But it's the worst situation we can have to manage, because these French children, they attack their own country.
In 2015, attacks in Paris would claim 146 lives. In May 2014, a French gunman shot and killed four people at a Jewish museum in the Belgian capital, Brussels. The attacker had returned from the war in Syria, where he'd fought with rebel groups against President Bashar al-Assad's forces. The Syrian conflict would also bring more than 1 million refugees to Europe's doorstep, while European economies remained mired in troubles of their own.
The 2015 refugee crisis was unprecedented in numbers. We're talking about a group that is pretty much impossible to accommodate, which increased a sense of crisis.
Europe was ill-prepared for a mass intake of new people, as weaker nations, many at the coalface of the refugee crisis, continue to struggle economically. 2015 saw Greece vote in a coalition led by the far-left Syriza party, but it failed to deliver on its anti-austerity promise. While Greeks bemoaned Brussels and Berlin calling the shots in Athens, Germans berated their government for bailing out the Greeks. For the European Union, the confluence of crises around violence, refugees, and failing economies was a troubling brew that called for tighter control. For Europe's far right, it would yield timely opportunity.
2015 created the perfect storm for the radical right because it had three developments that linked into the key agenda of the far right. And so the year started with the terrorist attacks in Charlie Hebdo in Paris and ended with it as well. But that brought in, first of all, nativism, because these were Muslims. But that also links to the security issue and the authoritarianism, state being too soft. Then we go into the Greek crisis, which was an economic crisis, where overall the far right didn't have a strong position. But the way that the EU treated it was perceived as very authoritarian and showed how limited national sovereignty was. Like, within the current EU, national states are no longer important, which again strengthened like the nativism and see we losing control. On the back of that comes the refugee crisis, which really just finishes it off, because first and foremost, of course, these are Muslim refugees, and so it links to the key issue that they have the key other who come in very large numbers, unprecedented numbers.
Refugee equals terrorist. Right. So by marrying people's anxiety about immigrants taking their jobs, so the economic anxieties over unemployment, stagnation, slow growth, etc., and on the other hand, the anxiety about safety and security because of terrorist attacks, that has produced, I think, a very powerful image for far-right parties to scapegoat a lot of the problems that Europeans are feeling.
In Germany, the far-right Alternative für Deutschland party looked to challenge Angela Merkel's Willkommenskultur refugee policy as Germany took in 1 million largely Syrian refugees. But a welcoming culture was far removed from what the AfD stood for.
One of the things that political scientists analyzed was always, so why doesn't Germany have a radical right party? And the answer was always that the elites, that the state institutions, but also the media, tried really hard to keep that threat down and acted very responsibly.
The rise of the AfD is, I think, in direct response, of course, to Merkel's policies. Its only real policy is an objection to large-scale immigration into Germany.
Das heißt, diejenigen, die fliehen vor Terror, vor Krieg, die Schutzgründe haben, sollen bei uns willkommen sein, und dazu stehen wir.
When she spoke about the Willkommenskultur or welcome culture, she actually welcomed refugees, but at the same time also said that we should be stricter towards economic immigrants. That completely fell flat there was virtually no support for her position. And she stood alone. And the person who really stood up to her was Viktor Orbán.
Ha a népvándorlást meg akarjuk állítani, először Brüsszelt kell megfékeznünk.
Orbán created a sense of crisis and invasion to strengthen his point. And so while it's true that Hungary saw a huge number of refugees coming to it, it didn't do anything to accommodate that.
Tilos kimondani, hogy a bevándorlás bűnözést és terrort hoz az országainkba.
Hungary's Prime Minister Viktor Orbán openly championed illiberalism, challenging press freedoms, the independence of the judiciary, and the idea of open borders. His right-wing policies appealed to populist fears and disregarded EU authority.
Orbán goes to Brussels and says, look, what's to do? Either Hungary becomes a corridor for migrants who want to go to Germany and Sweden, or we build a fence.
Orbán just laid out an alternative vision, and that alternative vision is exactly the same as a radical right vision. It says that we do not want multiculturalism. He literally says, Hungary for the Hungarians, Europe for the Europeans. Now, to a certain extent, over the last decades, people like Sarkozy or Merkel or Cameron say that multiculturalism has failed.
We've even tolerated these segregated communities behaving in ways that run completely counter to our values.
Multikulti und leben so nebeneinander her und freuen uns übereinander. Dieser Ansatz ist gescheitert. Absolut gescheitert.
So if you all the time hear from the West multiculturalism has failed, then why should you try it?
Many have found unsettling Orbán's response to the refugee crisis. Essentially, Orbán has said that he now views himself as the only defender of Europe's Judeo-Christian heritage, and that this, in effect, is a Muslim invasion of European democracies.
He says just straight out, like, Europe is a Christian continent, which is something that virtually no radical right party says.
Orbán signaled his vision of a Christian Europe, but also looked to check the advance of the extreme right, Jobbik party. Hungary's political landscape was now being shaped by far-right forces competing for power.
If we look at some of the statements that Orbán says versus some of the policy that Jobbik has put out there, they're sounding more and more similar.
Orbán considers Jobbik as his main threat. And this is probably one of the reasons why he has stepped up his game, in a sense, in terms of nationalism and the radical right.
Do you mind if I ask you whether you're ashamed at all of what Hungary did?
On the contrary, I'm very proud of what Hungary did.
But not just the construction of the fence, but,
yes,
for example, these courts that got set up in Szeged, where you criminalize refugees.
If they if they've crossed the frontier illegally.
But they're refugees, aren't they?
No. I would say at most 25% are refugees, the other 75 are economic migrants.
And I've met people who are running away from that.
Hungary is attempting very hard to break the business model of the smugglers, the human traffickers. We're doing not a bad job on this.
You're shaking your head.
Well, I just think a lot of this is anecdotal. I mean, where do you come up with these percentages? As 25% are refugees, 75% economic migrants are taking advantage of the situation. Look, I actually agree with you to some extent.
I can find the data for you. This isn't plucked out of the air. I've talked to people who are Arabic speaking, and they know somebody comes along and doesn't actually speak Arabic and says, I'm a Syrian. So for the most part, what Hungary did was to say, no, our Schengen obligations are there, the Dublin regulations are there. It's an intolerable situation where 200,000 people simply march through the country as if it weren't there.
An economic perspective that Hungary would actually stand to benefit the most? I've seen economic analysis of this, from an influx of labor because there's a huge shortage compared to almost any other EU country.
In which there isn't, the shortage is fairly recent, and not those people. We need IT specialists, not peasants.
It's extraordinary that if you wanted to call it a burden, you might think is a humanitarian obligation or even something to be proud of.
Well, no, I think Hungary has done, as a member of the European Union, more than anybody else, with the solidarity to build the fence to ensure that these people are properly registered and those who are not refugees are sent back. Because they shouldn't be there at all.
Yeah. Greece has done a lot more than most other countries.
First of all, when the crossing of the Aegean, there were obviously many of them, the largest group and the majority were Syrian refugees, so 70%, and some Afghanis and some from other parts of the world too, of course. Secondly, I think that this issue is one which shows where, had we worked as a European Union together, we would have dealt with it. Yes. So had we had a common border policy, now if everybody puts up fences...
Or a common form of liberal thinking, perhaps.
These are issues that we cannot solve alone. Hungary can solve it alone. I know that Greece cannot solve it alone. The initial reaction is, let's close our windows, our doors, our borders.
Because in the end...
let's close our borders. You cannot do it. It'll be a pandemic.
There's a word in this discussion which we haven't heard yet.
Ethnicity.
No, Willkommenskultur. How does Angela Merkel impose a policy on the whole of Europe without consultation?
Well, because she doesn't mind about issues to do with ethnicity and religion.
That's not the point. How does she have the legitimacy to say...
Viktor Orban says he's a defender of Christian
Europe.
I decide what
Europe's policies should be. If we're going to do things together, it has to be done together.
Here we might agree on the fact that maybe Merkel should not be the one to make the decisions. But we do need to make common decisions on this issue.
I think, and Orban has come up with various proposals. She imposed it on the rest of Europe without consultation. That's the problem. If we're going to do things together as Europeans...
You could say that the same thing, that Hungary did the same thing too, just on the opposite direction.
Well, it's just but that there is Schengen, there is Dublin.
So I would agree with much more with, and I would commend what Merkel did. But one of the problems is that we don't have a common policy. We have to sit down. And now that's why I'm saying Europe can be. We are underutilizing the capacity that Europe has. And that, I think, has fed into populism. That has fed to people saying it's not solving our issues, it's only creating more problems.
Forgive me for just coming back to this, but I think it is crucial in terms of the framing of the argument from the point of view of the new power brokers in Europe. Religion and ethnicity are absolutely critical in this as well, because Viktor Orban says he's trying to save Christian Europe, and any number of these politicians like him say Islam has no place in Europe. There might have been a unified position if these refugees had been Christians and not Muslims. Would you not think?
It's a question of choice. Now, various Western countries took a choice to be multicultural. Central Europe is saying we've taken a choice not to be multicultural. What's your problem?
I think this is a slippery slope logically, because once you start going down that path, you say, well, you know, we've chosen to be a socialist democratic republic. We've chosen to be racist. We've chosen to leave out person X or Y because of their skin color, because of their religion, from our nation. And that's our choice to say these people don't belong here. And why can't we be part of the EU and still make that choice?
The question of choice, I think, is a real one. And it's summarized in unity and diversity. So the question, European Union slogan, so how much unity, how much diversity?
Do you think the migration crisis has been one of the things that actually could lead to it being eventually pushed over the cliff?
I think that we need a different type of a narrative and leadership to deal with this. I think we've scapegoated migrants for a lot of the other issues. The fact that we don't have a welfare system, you have this populist welfare chauvinism. So it's sort of saying, okay, welfare, but just for me. Mm. Well, the question is if it's only welfare for me, you're going to get a divided society, and you're going to get employers who are going to say, I'm not going to pay benefits to these foreigners, and therefore, actually, we're going to undermine the welfare system.
I think what you're saying is completely true, but we're also going back to this question of identity. You know, who belongs in the nation state? Who belongs in the European community, right? In Europe, I think that has excluded or hasn't really had the visionary thinking to include people who are Muslim, for example, for a long time. It hasn't really included people who are from Northern Africa, right? But until you have a more expansive vision of what it means to be German. That's not just about being you know, white and being from Bavaria or something like this, or from Hamburg or wherever. That's when you will get some actual change.
Every identity will necessarily exclude as well as include. The key is where you draw that dividing line.
And where would you like to draw that line?
Well, that would take us into a very different discussion, which I'm quite happy to have
can
with you.
I just pursue a question to you, which picks up on your thoughts about the nation state, which is, after all, exactly the narrative of people like Marine Le Pen and others who said the nation state is back and federalism is out and all this sort of thing. Is not the chaotic response to the refugee crisis and the way it's been used by anti-EU political figures the greatest gift that Vladimir Putin ever could have had if he wanted to try to undermine the European Union without actually doing anything himself?
Well, look, I think if 2016 has been a good year for anybody, it's been for Vladimir Putin. There's no question about that. I think Russia is benefiting incredibly from the refugee crisis, from the bump in electoral support that crisis has given to the anti-EU populace, with which Russia has established a very clear, in some cases financial, but also ideological alliance. So Vladimir Putin is having a wonderful year.
Western Europe's liberalism was being challenged by right-wing Christian governments. For Russian leader Vladimir Putin, long regarded as an illiberal force by the West, this would be an opportunity to serve Russia's interests and widen cracks in Europe's unity.
The Kremlin, under the guidance of President Putin, particularly since 2012, has been heavily investing in parties and political leaders that he sees as destabilizing for the European Union. They have developed a network of influence across Western and Eastern Europe that can be activated almost like Trojan horses across the region at just the right moments.
President Putin does seem to be subsidizing the far right in Europe. It's known that he's been arranging soft loans to the Front National in France. As far as I know, he's been giving support to far-right movements elsewhere in the continent. And I'm sure President Putin is absolutely happy to continue doing this and to hope that all this pays off in a Europe that disintegrates.
Hello, how are you? All right.
The disintegration of Britain from Europe was the question put to the British people in a referendum in 2016. In the week before the referendum was to take place, a pro-EU, pro-immigration British MP, Joe Cox, was murdered by a man later confirmed to be a white supremacist.
The perpetrator of the attack argues that the white race is quickly becoming extinct. And this is a common idea that runs through the European far right.
But very soon, I mean, we forget about the fact that Britain has experienced what seems to be a far right political assassination of a member of parliament. And it speaks to the kind of acceptability of a certain kind of far-right set of politics now in British political life.
We've got our country back!
Britain would vote to leave the European Union, proving for some the acceptability of that certain kind of politics.
UKIP and the Conservatives have mobilised, essentially, an older, white, working-class, left-behind electorate that delivers them victory, especially in economically struggling parts of England.
Not everyone who voted Leave was a racist or an Islamophobe or a xenophobe, but the discourse of that movement was clearly mobilizing around Islamophobia and around a xenophobia and racism.
Oui, il est possible de sortir de l'Union européenne. Le Royaume-Uni vient d'initier un mouvement qui ne s'arrêtera pas.
Brexit was the first significant victory in foreign policy for the radical right. So far, the far right has not really been seen as a major player in foreign policy. And so this is huge. And it has inspired like Marine Le Pen, Geert Wilders, and others.
Britain's exit from the EU was aided by a populist, anti-establishment xenophobia now coursing through the continent. 2016 saw Angela Merkel's Christian Democrats beaten into third place by the far-right AFD party in local elections. While Germany endured a year of violent attacks that spotlighted its refugee policy. In the same year, France's Front National leader Marine Le Pen made significant gains in presidential election polls.
Vive la France!
Austria came close to electing a far-right head of state. And Italy rejected constitutional reforms for not being radical enough, prompting the resignation of its centrist leader. The project to unite Europe that began in the wake of a devastating war was now being challenged by populist stirrings in the nations it sought to bring together.
The European project in itself was pushed through by the centrist parties, both on the left and on the right, across Western Europe specifically. And these parties are now paying the price. What we're really seeing in Europe today is a thinning out of the center, where the extremist flanks on both sides are gaining, and the center, both left and right, almost find themselves, you know, I don't want to be too vulgar, like with their pants down.
I don't know if Marine Le Pen will succeed in winning the next presidential election. But if we don't change this political situation in France, one day she will succeed in it.
The one thing that we do know over the past 100 and so years of European history is political projects, political parties have come and gone, but nationalism has remained stubbornly persistent.
These are very dangerous moments for Europe. We see important elections coming in Germany and in France in the wake of Brexit. But we see the rise of so-called populist movements, not just across Europe, but in the US and elsewhere. And the danger, it seems to me, at the moment is retreating into our own little backyards and forgetting precisely what it was that demanded the integration of Europe in the first place. The catastrophe of World War II was what brought about the integration of Europe. And it was an imperfect process. But if it's abandoned altogether, then what will the consequences of that be?